I want to begin by thanking the government of Odisha, all of the various people whom Subrata and Sushmita have magically built relationships with over the last few years that they have been here, and we have been touched by that, Swati and I, over the last 2 days that we have come. And this is, we've had many experiences over the last 20 years we've been in India, where we know how forced respect is given. What we have seen over the last 2 days is a genuine warmth of treating us as guests of your state. So thank you very much. We've been touched by that. I see an old friend, Sanjeev, here. Good to see you, Sanjeev. We also have some connections on the urban mafia through the years that we have built. So some of you are close to us as we've connected with you over the years. I do have one complaint, though, of Subrata. You could have chosen any other topic than the one that I have to speak on today for a venue like this. Because this is about the driest, most complex topic that one can talk about on such beautiful beaches. So I would much rather use my 45 minutes to tell you how my wife and I got married. And frankly, that's a great story. Okay? I'm a South Indian Tamilian, she's a Gujarati Jain. And our story was Dilwale Dunaliya Le Jayenge multiplied by 2. Okay? It had all the romance, all the comedy, all the action, including the strife and the conflicts with her two brothers who are comfortably in Singapore, and we get along well now. It was not the case then. But I have a duty to do, and there is no free lunch. So I do have somewhat of a complex presentation, but I'm delighted that the group today, and I know it's unusual that we're here doing the OK session with only the IAS officers, as opposed to how it's been done in the 22 previous occasions in Bhubaneswar. In a way, I think I'm glad, because this topic probably needs a level of sophistication and engagement which might resonate with you all. I can't assure that, but I can certainly say it reflects our learnings and our thinking on how to deal with complex changes. So while I'm waiting for it to come up, I know all of you know Subrata and Sushmita, but I have a unique perspective, because not only are they friends whom we met from the time we returned to India a little over 20 years ago, because they started Mindtree, he and his fellow founders of that institution, virtually around the time that we returned to India. And I've had the privilege, and I say this with full sincerity, of serving on the board of Mindtree when Subrata was the chairman for over 5 years. And it has been an unforgettable experience for me, seeing a remarkable leader in action, living his thoughts and his principles on a day-to-day basis. So Subrata, back at you on the compliments. So I'll tour through this fairly quickly. I do want to get into the substantive issues which I think would interest you all and hopefully open up some points of discussion as we go through it. As Subrata has said, for Swati and me, this journey over the last 20 years has been exclusively focused on urban change. So I can say with some amount of lack of humility that we understand the urban problem quite well. Also, for us, this journey has not been trying to do this just as outsiders. Although we have been outside government, we've always believed in seeing real change happen. And real change cannot happen unless you engage with government itself, whether it's with the bureaucratic system or with the political system. And we've done our fair share of that. Not that every one of those was successful, but we've approached it with an open-mindedness and a pragmatism, which has allowed us to understand these problems a little better. So I'll walk you through a little bit of our learnings, more to set the context for the larger issues of system change, which I think is useful for today. And then I'll walk you through all of the points that are following, ending with, of course, the important thing, which is leadership. All of you know this, so I won't spend time. India has passed the tipping point of urbanization. This data is public data, but the data actually measures it less than what is actually happening on the ground. So by 2030, India is not going to be just 40%. In our view, it's going to be closer to 50%, because India has the highest bar of defining urbanization of any country in the world. We use three parameters of minimum size, minimum density, and 75% of the male members of that settlement having a non-agricultural income. No other country in the world uses all these three definitions. If we use the definition that China uses for urbanization, India would be 12% more urbanized than it is today. So we're understating urbanization. And there are politics in this as well, because you do lose some of the rural grants if you reclassify a settlement from a panchayat to a town. over 75% of GDP growth, over 80% of incremental employment growth, and so on. So this is known. But massive challenges in service delivery. Again, I'm not going to spend time on this. We had an outstanding session this morning with Mati talking us through the Jaga mission. We're both quite keen on that. Swati has done lots of work on land title and tenure and so on. So the question is, beyond the obvious, how do we fix this problem? And we must begin by acknowledging it's a complex problem. But it's not a complex big problem. It's actually a complex problem at the level of a city or a settlement multiplied. So the phrase we use is, India doesn't have 100,000 problems in its cities. It had 100 problems repeated 1,000 times. And you can say the same of Bhubaneswar. You can say the same of Odisha. All of these problems are repeating across. So what you see in Delhi, whether it's the pollution in the winter, what you see in Mumbai with the flooding, what you see with the lakes in Bangalore, you can replace the name of the city, you can replace it with Bhubaneswar or Cuttack or whatever else, and the problems would repeat. So we need to have a method of thinking about this problem which recognizes its inherent complexity. And this is the metaphor that we use, like an iceberg. What we see above the iceberg is the visible quality of life that we experience. And when I say we, I mean across the spectrum of citizens, poor, middle class, and rich, which is the good thing about cities in India. We are all, they are equal opportunity offenders. Everybody's life is getting messed up, whether or not you are poor or middle class or rich. And all it takes is a visit to any of the developed countries to see the difference. And we've all experienced it. The question is, what is it that drives that quality of life in those beautiful European towns that we can walk across and those cities in the US or the UK? What's driving it is what is beneath the surface of the iceberg, which is the systemic issues that they have fixed. And they have fixed it not because they are supremely ordained. They have fixed it because they have had longer to fix it. They have had 200, 250 years to fix their problems. We are running at the speed of globalization as we are urbanizing, so that 30% becoming 40, becoming 50 is hundreds of millions of people coming into our cities and towns. It's a complex problem to fix. But unless we see that there's something underneath, and that something underneath is a systems issue. And you can take any problem, take garbage as an example. It's not just a question of household segregation. It's not just a question of transporting of this household segregation with all its attendant challenges of contractor, mafia, and everything else. It's not just the question of where is that location for the deposition of the waste and how is it going to be treated so that the leachates don't go into the soil and end up messing it. Whether the village that where this has been located has been planned earlier or not. Is this sufficient to meet not just the current requirements, but geographically the spatial requirements? It is an interrelated aspect of more than 3 to 4 dimensions. I won't come to this right away. I'll pause on the urban problem and come back to a little bit of our diagnosis of it. But I want to use that to go slightly bigger. One of the things that we've learned about the IAS Biradari in Odisha is that many of you are technocrats. You're engineers or doctors. You've had substantial amounts of technical expertise. And I'm sure that during this journey, you must have experienced courses. How many of you have had a course or exposed to systems theory? When you were in college, I'm not going to ask you questions, so feel free to put up your hands. So you remember anything on systems at all, systems theory? Well, what we learned as engineers in college was what I call hard systems. Hard systems. Anybody recognize what those pieces are? No points for guessing, it's pretty straightforward, right? It is a bicycle. So this is an example of hard systems, a very simple, primitive example of hard systems. What do I mean by that? The system has got components. It's got a seat, it's got handlebars, it's got wheels, pedal, chain, etc. Unless the components of that system come together, but not just come together randomly, but come together in a predefined configuration, the overall system won't work. But there is a formula to put it together. And that formula is the same whether you're dealing with a bicycle or you're dealing with a nuclear power plant. The level of complexity is higher, but it is the same approach, which is an engineering approach to systems thinking. the problems that we are dealing with, whether it's urbanization or anything else, are not these problems. They are not hard system problems. There is no formula. The first person from an analytical standpoint who actually talked about this is a gentleman in the 70s at UC Berkeley called Horst Ritter. And he and his co-author came up with this term called wicked problems. And they basically defined wicked problems as multiple things. But importantly, there is no common definition of the problem itself. It depends on your perspective. So as an example, many of you know the US cities had major problems about urban sprawl, about too much of private transportation, not enough public transport. Now, how do you understand that problem? If you're an automobile manufacturer, you want that to continue. You want more and more capital investment to come into road networks. If you are a political representative, you have a different definition of that problem. If you are a community member, you have a different definition of that problem. And there is no correct answer to this. The fact that there are multiple stakeholders in a system means that the definition of that system itself is going to be subjective. These multiple actors have their own agendas, and I don't mean agenda in a bad way. Everybody has a legitimate point of view by which they want to see that problem addressed. And therefore, it complicates how you solve the problem. And there is no final solution, unlike putting the bicycle together, unlike putting the nuclear power plant together, where there is a moment when you can say, this job is done. In soft systems, there is no done. There is no moment where you declare victory. You move the system from one level of equilibrium to another level of equilibrium. And if you act with some amount of coherence and cogency, the second level of equilibrium is superior to what you found it at. That is all we can expect. It's really, really important to understand it, especially in this room. And why do I say that? I won't get into this in great detail because it's a messy problem, but the way to solve soft systems problems has a certain method to it, and this method has been refined over the last several decades. For the moment, I'll skip past this. Why is this important? Because literally every problem that those of you, especially in this room, the leaders of our administrative apparatus, the problems that you deal with are all soft systems problems. Whether it's education, whether it's healthcare, whether it's skilling leading to employment, whether it's urbanization, and I'm just listing out a few here. They're all soft systems problems. You cannot solve it in a linear, technocratic way, and it doesn't matter how competent you are. The degrees of moving parts are just too many. But that does not mean that you just let go and don't attempt to solve it, or solve it in a tactical way, which is what most of us end up doing, which is take a very transactional view, and it gets compounded because you have a 3-year or a 5-year tenure to say, let me just do as much as I can before I get rotated out. My submission to you is, you don't have to do that. My submission to you is that you can take a more enlightened view if you see that this is a systems problem and it can be approached in a slightly more sophisticated way. Let me then, with this background, walk you through a few slides of the work that we did in Janagraha to try and unbundle the complexity of the urban problem. So we've come up with a framework called city systems, which is basically to say, recognize that the city challenge is a complex systems challenge, but we've taken it one step further to say there is a framework that we can use to understand what that city system is. And that framework has got four components to it. What is the spatial character of the city? Do you have adequate spatial planning instruments to do justice to how that city's spatial character is? That's the first. The second, what are the urban resources and capacities to manage that city? Resources being financial resources and capacities meaning human capacities. So just to give you a small data point on this, the city of Bangalore and the city of New York are both almost the same size from a population standpoint. Bangalore actually has now edged ahead of New York, both approximately 10 million people. You'll be astonished to know that the city of New York employs 350,000 people to run the city. 350,000 people. And this is only apple to apple services. For example, they have law and order and police under the city, we're not including it. Comparison under the 12th schedule for the 18 functions that ULPs in India do, 350,000. Do you know what the authorized staff for Bangalore City Corporation is? 18,000. Of which the filled posts is 12,000. So we have a massive quantity problem in the capacity issue. But it's compounded by a quality problem. 5% of the organization chart of the city of New York are made up of people who are 20 to 25 years of technical qualification and experience in that issue. It could be mass transportation, it could be parks and recreation, it could be juvenile crime, it could be community outreach. In Indian cities, in Bangalore as an example, that number is less than 0.5%. So the head of waste management in Bangalore doesn't have a public health background. Not because we don't want him to have it, but imagine, you, many of you would have been commissioners of either small towns or big cities in your career. You never had the time to even engage with this problem. This was a given. This was something outside of your control. Especially given budgetary challenges that we have, how can we even conceive adding? But unfortunately, we have this bubble problem in India where we do have an overstaffing problem at an aggregate level in government. But there are certain areas like sunrise areas of urbanization where it's understaffed, where there is an overstaffing somewhere else. But we need to be creative to address it, because it is one of the factors in the systems issue. You just don't have the capability, both on quantity and quality. The financial resources adds to this. That's the second aspect of the systems problem. The third is well known to all of you, empowered local governments. Everybody has talked about it, mayor and so on, so I won't dwell on it. But it's also the legitimacy of these elected representatives. I'll give you one example of it. In the UK, there is a law that prevents somebody who stands for public office to have a conflict of interest if they are receiving, say, some contractual benefits from the same municipality. So you might have been a contractor, but the moment you stand for public office and win, nobody in you or your immediate family can have pecuniary benefits. So you either have to give up those contracts or not stand for office. All of us know that that's not true in virtually every municipality or corporation in India. Most garbage contracts are held either by councillors or their family members. That's a huge issue that comes in decision making. Again, this is not to point fingers, but it's to recognize that it's an element of the system. And the last of it is transparency and participation. So there's four components that come together to cause the system. The garbage problem I talked about is actually a manifestation of dysfunctionality across all four. Where are we locating the garbage dump? Do we have enough people and money to manage this well? Who is the people who are making decisions? And do we have citizen involvement? It's not enough to tell people segregate at source. If everybody who is asked to segregate knows that 5 kilometers from my house, that garbage is getting re-aggregated and dumped into the same landfill. So there's a process by which we have to get all the pieces to come together. We actually quantified this so that we could use this as a means to communicate a complicated problem and then get change. So it's like a diagnostic. It's like getting a health checkup done. So we evaluated 26 cities across India, but we also evaluated 2 comparable cities, New York and London. And last 2 years back, we added a South African city, Johannesburg. Here's what the data says. So that's data over 3 years. Essentially, it's a simple score on 10 across the 4 parameters. You can see New York and London are at 9 or 10. They've slightly decreased over the years, but they're still above 8 on 10. And what it shows is that bottom of the iceberg. The reason you see the quality of life when you go there is because their quality of city systems is extraordinarily strong. No Indian city got more than 4 on 10. Pune is the only city that managed to move a little bit higher in 2017. What I've just shown you is actually only one part of the soft systems issue. Janagraha itself is taking a technocratic view. So in some sense, this is a confession. It is not possible for an NGO sitting outside government to actually lead this kind of change? So the best we can do is to analyze it and bring it to people like you within government, because the true champions of the kind of system change that is needed has to come from within government, because that's where the power resides, that's where the leverage, the policy making capacities reside. So all that I showed you was not the entire framework of soft systems. It is only the analytical piece of soft systems for the real hard work to begin. So this is what the ASICS diagnosis says, and I must say we've been at this now with this framework for the last 5 years, and our own measure of how successful have we been to inch forward on change, 20% success, because it's very, very hard. With that background, let me get to the meat of what I want to talk about. And these next few slides are really important. And it goes to the heart of this, saying, when this session ends, which it will at 12 o'clock, and then you'll go back to enjoying the beach and your lunch and your camaraderie with the friends of your network, I hope that some of this will stick with you. There is a framework. This is a solvable problem, but it needs leadership. And it needs an approach, it needs a framework. It's like everything else. There has to be a method to solving it. Some of the best thinkers on institutions and leadership have written about this. Subrata and I share admiration for one of them, Peter Senge. So Peter Senge is one of the co-authors of this framework, which is, how do you look at soft systems change? It's an inverted pyramid. There are three levels, and I need to walk you through each of these. The explicit is the world of rules that we run by, the policies, the practices, the resources, the money we allocate in the budgetary and the people and so on. The second is what's driving those, the relationships and connections, and the power dynamics. And these power dynamics are both explicit, which means I am secretary or principal secretary responsible for something, but there are implicit power dynamics as well. And if you want to see systems change happen, you as the person running that department needs to be able to have a very clear sense of what are those linkages. But the most important element of it is the one at the bottom of that inverted pyramid, which is the mental models. It is not only the most important, it is the hardest to change. So these are the brief definitions of each of those. At the very highest, and they are the most explicit, because that is the one we want to change. The policies, the practices, the resource flows, rules, regulations, priorities, I'll let you read this for yourself. The relationships and connections and the power dynamics are in the semi-visible, and the mental models, because the truth of it is, every one of you has already got a mental model on the issue that you are responsible to solve. The question is, how rigidly are you holding on to that mental model? Are you willing to subject that to the scrutiny that it deserves and open it up for challenging? And is that mental model capable of addressing the challenges of a systems problem? Because if it's not, that mental model is not going to take you very far. It's like getting fit. If your mental model for getting fit is only to diet, you will get some initial benefits, but it's not going to get you to the end point, because getting fit and being healthy requires a number of different things. Why is leadership necessary for this? You run departments with hundreds, sometimes thousands of people across the spectrum of your departments. This stuff is hard, and it doesn't happen overnight. And mid-level people, if I take education example, a principal of a school, a public school, is going to get intimidated by this. And will the only response in a public institutional system when you get intimidated by a problem is to say, let me reduce the problem to something that gives me sense every day when I get up and do the best I can and solve it very tactically. Now that might either make no difference at all to the problem, or at best it will solve the problem a little bit for a short period of time. neither of those is useful. So you have to trigger the change only with leadership. This is the responsibility of systems leadership. In our view, my entire career was in the private sector. The last 20 years has been engaging with public leaders, both bureaucrats as well as politicians. And I can say this with complete humility. Your job is the toughest job there is. There is no other job that we have seen which comes even close to the kind of jobs that you have to do. You're dealing with massive degrees of externalities. Most things are out of your control. The problems are incredibly hard to solve. And you have a 3 to 5 year tenure. You don't even know what the longevity of that tenure is when you take your job. And you're supposed to make the change happen. And this is not even including things like the politics of it and everything else. So even if it was just a technical problem, it's incredibly complex to solve. And you're every day dealing with this urgent versus important issue. I mean, we all use this phrase, but it's true. Just because it's a cliche doesn't make it irrelevant. It became a cliche because it's true. Every day you're dealing with it. So how do you respond to it? And my submission is, you need some framework. It all begins with what is your mental model? And I want to submit to you, a systems approach is the only comprehensive way to solve it. So the question is, how will you allocate the time? How will you take the trouble to understand what that systems approach is and apply it to your work? Practical, this isn't some highfalutin science, because there is no, I mean, this is not like art of living. There is no magic formula, do pranayama and you will solve this problem. There's nothing like that. So really a question of allocating time. Have a twin track approach. I feel this really helps. Whatever you're doing now, please allocate the bulk of your time to doing it in that manner. But please set aside an incremental amount of time. And that incremental amount of time is entirely a function of how much you want to give. But if it's not even 25%, there's a problem. Because that means you're not going to give it the momentum that it needs. Because it's a new beginning. Second, recognize that even though for all the good things I have said about government and the role that you play, you cannot solve this problem yourself. When I say you, I mean government. Virtually none of the system's problems can be resolved by any one stakeholder. You have to reach out in collaboration. And that collaboration has to happen in a manner that runs against your service conditioning. Let me repeat that. Your service conditioning has been drilled into you all as hierarchical. You have an amazing ability to manage hierarchical relationships. But over the years, as an IAS officer, your ability to manage lateral relationships has been eroded. Relationships that are not based on power. Relationships that are based on mutual respect, understanding somebody brings domain expertise to the table, therefore being challenged just for the quality of the ideas that you're bringing to the table. Over the years of your service, that capability gets eroded. I don't know why. Maybe it's a coping mechanism because of the service rules. But the truth of it, as well-wishers from outside government, I can tell you this, it is a rare officer that we meet who fulfills what we call the three filter test. So let me tell you what the three filter test is. The first filter is, do you admit there is a problem? In our experience, 90% of officers, especially when you're sitting with a chief minister or a minister who's in charge of that portfolio, 90% will say, sir, everything is okay, sir, sab theek hai, sir, under control. Only 10% will actually acknowledge that there is a problem. The second filter is, Do you acknowledge that you cannot solve the problem yourself? And of the 10%, another 90% will fail that test. Because they'll say, yes, sir, problem hai, lekin hum solve kar rahe hain, sir, isko. Sab theek hai, sir. We are fixing it, we are allocating the resources, we are managing it. Because somehow there is a sense of vulnerability to acknowledge that I cannot solve it myself. This leads to the third filter, which is, are you willing to reach out to others in a level relationship to help you to solve the problem? And of the 10% who come to the third filter, only 10% of that are able to solve the answer the third question, yes. So we honestly, constantly in our work, search for those officers who answer all the three questions. And that number is 2 to 4%. Because these are the officers, and that doesn't mean that the persons who are not answering yes to the first part are bad people. You just have a different mental model. And that is why the mental model is so important. Your mental model somehow is that I have to solve this problem myself. Acknowledging that I cannot solve it myself is a constraint, is somehow a sign of weakness. It is not a sign of weakness. You have unlimited access to resources and ideas and capabilities if you are willing to open up. And you cannot solve a soft systems problem unilaterally. So, create a collaborative ecosystem. But you have to own that problem and make sure that it gets driven by government. Because only you know all the constraints and the pitfalls. And there are hundreds of pitfalls. They could be political pitfalls. They could be sensitivities, election time. Hundreds of those variables that only you are aware of. So anchor it. And better still, beautiful, amazing young officers who are coming through the system, and they need not be IAS officers, they could be people in the state cadre. You know them best when you see the gems. Put them in charge on this track too. Anyway, you're not going to allocate too much resources to it because you have to deal with the urgent. But allocate some resources, create an ecosystem and an environment which allows for the oxygen of new ideas to come in, new perspectives, to then solve the problem. Then, as I said, the explicit, which is the policies and the resources, are the ones that happen at the end. And when you're starting to solve the problem, you can't go and change the act or the rule. That comes later. So invest heavily in level 2 and level 3. Invest heavily in the relationships and the power equations. And by the way, neither of these is a static outcome. It's not a given. You will be surprised if you open your mind to understand what are the sources of new relationships, new networks, new stakeholders who can come in. Similarly, you will be surprised how many more sources of power there are beyond the confines of government. It's a sensitive subject, I won't elaborate on it, but this is a question each of you has to probe. But you have to invest heavily in level 2 and level 3. And in this, and by the way, one thing that Subroto does actually, I think, intuitively, but he's honed the skill, is the next point. Recognize the power of storytelling. Recognize the power of narrative. And your examples, it would be the pilot programs. And you do this instinctively. We've seen great officers, very effective officers, have a large scale agenda, but they'll do the pilot, but you won't stop with the pilot. You know that you have to act with speed to convert the pilot into something bigger, to create that irreversible momentum before you get transferred. But use that pilot success, use the narrative of that, and the narrative storytelling could be within your system, could be getting awards, could be getting media coverage, whatever else. Could be getting champions to talk about it in first-hand terms of how they got impacted by it, and so on. Don't waste a crisis, we know this already. So, plenty of opportunities to move at disproportionate speed. Sometimes you have to accept, especially in India, there are lots of windows of time where you can't move fast. That's the nature of it. But there are moments of time when you can move extraordinarily fast. when the change which you think would take months can happen in 2 days? Because the PS to the Chief Minister comes and says something, windows opened, CM suddenly thought about it, but you can't then say, I need 3 weeks. That's a matter of 24 hours. That's a matter of 3 days. And remarkable change can happen in that short window of time. Last point, I don't know if you can see it. There's this beautiful phrase called urgent patience. I don't know if you've heard of this term, this story about this person traveling around, goes to this village and asks somebody, if I planted a seed for a tree, how long would it take to grow? And this person said, oh, that would take 30 years to grow. So the man says, then I don't have a minute to lose. So that's what urgent patience is. Somehow we feel just because things take time that we can act slowly. But urgent patience is, some things will take time, but you have to make every day count. I have last two slides. And the first of it is a little bit of my own storytelling for systems change. This is, I'm sure that many of you are skeptics about this, but let me tell you, this is the new, there's always, every time in change, there's some new ism, there's some new currency. This is one of those new currencies. Across the world, within government, in some of the largest philanthropies in the world, across the non-profit sector, this term called systems change is running like wildfire. Some of the most thoughtful people, OECD has just put out a remarkable study, you can go Google it, find it on the web. That's the one that systems changed. Because a lot of times, the point was, you could do this outside government, but it's virtually impossible to do systems change in government. As I said earlier, if there is a place to do systems change, it actually is government, because virtually everything you do is a systems problem. Stanford Social Innovation Review, SSIR, has put out an outstanding piece. The largest philanthropy, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, the Michael and Susan Dell Foundation, many of the foundations in Europe, especially in Northern Europe, are all moving rapidly to systems change. Our own engagement, we just signed, one of our institutions last month just signed an MOU with the government of Odisha. So we're delighted, Swati and I are very happy that Janakaha is actually partnering with the government of Odisha. But the genesis of that partnership actually came from a systems change conversation. Because the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, as some of you may know, only cares about public health issues. But over the 10 years of doing public health, they've realized that you can't solve public health without solving the challenge of cities, because it's a horizontal. City is the space on which some of these vertical issues, whether it's public health or primary education or skilling and jobs, they intersect. So if you want to solve a vertical, you can't solve it in isolation. You have to solve it by acknowledging the horizontal. So, and finally, the analysis that's been done on, independently on, a systems approach to social change. So let me conclude with this slide. Most problems in government are systems challenges. That's a loaded phrase, ambitious leaders. So in some sense, it's a challenge to each of you. Do you want to mark time in the role that you've got? Do you want to leave something behind that survives you? And if that is the case, and your ambition, not for yourself, but for the change that you're responsible for, is powerful, then my submission is, you should include some amount of your time on thinking about doing this with a systems approach. You cannot solve it in the linear manner in which we've been addressing social challenges in the past. The upside is that this is, once you get this engine moving, it's remarkable payoffs. And they not just survive you, but somebody who follows you can build upon it So the multiplier effect is significant for system change because it's an ecosystem. All the stakeholders are involved. The institutional memory of what you have put in motion is not going to depart with you. But the flip side of it is, it's not easy. If it was easy, it would have been done by now. So that's the challenge as well. So I'll conclude by saying another reason to have a twin track approach. In the early days when Swati and I came back to India and started working with officers, as I said, the three filter test came much later through our learnings. But we would meet officers, some of whom would be very, you know, unwilling to do anything, and others would be jumping up and down with enthusiasm and say, you know, yes, I want to do this and I want to do something else and engage with us, let's do this together. And after 4 or 5 months of working with them, their own enthusiasm would abate and they would tell us some stories. So one of those stories was by this enthusiastic young IAS officer who said, you know, my problem why I'm not being too effective is that people in my own state cadre tell me, you're a KTP, you know what KTP is, keen type person. So too enthusiastic, too naive, be a little less energetic about all this. So another reason to do twin track approach, don't let people feel that you're too romantic. Take a twin track, spend 60 to 70% doing your work the way you used to do it, but at least set aside some percentage, a reasonable chunk of it, for doing something different. At the very minimum, I think it will expand your frontiers about how you think about and execute on the challenges that you have. Thank you.